Now, I've covered a fair number of cases up till now, and many of them seem to be focused on men who lash out at their love interest or significant other. Today's case is no exception, but this isn't a trend I've particularly sought out. And the reason for covering the case I've chosen today will become clear towards the end of today's story. With that said, we need to crack on and look at what seems, from the outside looking in, a picture-perfect couple looking forward to the rest of their lives together. But as we know, that's rarely the true story behind the smiles. This is Murder of Crows. The year is 2005, and in Hull, up in the north of the UK, a young couple are waking up on Valentine's Day. Their plans got bumped when Paul Dyson was told he had to work. So the couple exchanged cards and shared a kiss before Dyson headed off to work. No doubt a pattern was happening in homes across the UK at this time. But in truth, we don't actually know what happened in that home on that particular morning. But what we do know is that after this alleged sequence of events, Joanne Nelson was neither seen nor heard from again, and she was soon declared a missing person. But let's rewind a little and look at the lead characters in this particular story. Joanne Nelson was an ambitious and attractive 22-year-old, mature beyond her years, with definite plans to move forward, make the most of life, and succeed in her career. Her sister described her as very trusting, considerate, and easy to talk to. But the chance meeting that would shape the rest of her life happened a couple of years earlier, when she was at a night out at the Mint Bar and Club in Hull. She met a doorman called Paul Dyson. He was 8 years her senior, but he was muscular and considered good looking, and his superficial charm was enough to turn her head, and soon the two were dating. Paul Dyson had a history and a background which was the very blueprint for a dysfunctional asshole. Not that he revealed any of this to the trusting Joanne as they dated and eventually moved in together. His shady background began with his father, Peter Dyson, who Paul put on a pedestal. But it was a pedestal coated liberally in blood, as Dyson Sr. had killed two men. The first in 1967, after he stabbed a man his wife was having an affair with. Later, in 1974, he killed a father of seven in a hit-and-run accident. The first incident saw him serve 6 years in prison for manslaughter, but somehow he was never prosecuted in relation to the second incident. It did not bode well that the man he idolised so much had such a bleak past. But the warnings about Dyson's nature didn't end there. He had numerous drunken attacks on his first wife. He had abused steroids in the past when he was focused on bodybuilding at any cost. Not that Joanne was aware of any of this, as Dyson had made a point of hiding his past and trying to appear the ever-considerate boyfriend. But a couple of years down the line, all was not well for the couple, as they bickered often. Dyson's tendency to bemoan his place in the world and blame anyone but himself for his lack of drive and ambition did nothing to convince the ambitious Joanne that there was a future with Dyson. He was jealous of her wide circle of friends and rarely did anything to help in the household, which drove a further wedge between the two. However, when Joanne vanished seemingly into thin air on Valentine's Day 2005, he portrayed the very image of the shell-shocked partner. It seems he played the part so well that even Joanne's family were convinced by him, at least at first. As a full-scale search for the young lady swung into action, Dyson seemed at a loss with what to do. But like all good narcissists, he couldn't stay out of the spotlight for long, and he decided to appear in the media on the 16th of February, making a tearful appeal for her return. We will return to this video shortly as we look at how this approach backfired spectacularly on him. Joanne's parents, Charlie and Jean, appeared in an official police press conference to appeal for information the next day, which was the 17th of February. Over the next few days, Joanne no-showed her best friend's father's funeral, and then she didn't get in touch with her sister Katie on her birthday, neither of which she would have missed for anything. And this led to family and friends starting to think that she had come to harm. But by this time, Dyson had already been arrested, with a key detail from his tearful TV appeal being critical in pointing fingers squarely at the poor grieving boyfriend. Let's take a look at his appeal video and see what we think of it.
Monday morning, because I couldn't get Valentine's Day off, we swapped cards upstairs. I gave her a kiss and a cuddle, got ready for work. And she was going to get her head down for another hour or so.
What does Joanne mean to you?
She's the only person I truly love. I want to know where she is. I want her back.
With Dyson having been charged on February the 21st, The next few weeks passed with Dyson categorically denying that he had deliberately caused Joanne's death. So the classic, an accident happened and I panicked story. But we know that gentle hammering breaks the stone, and repeated interviews of Dyson yielded fragments of information about a possible location for Joanne. And though it was vague and fragmented, Detective Superintendent Ray Higgins, the senior investigating officer of the inquiry, felt there was enough to start searching for possible locations, which were gated paths near country roads that had piles of bottles nearby. Now, on March 17th, a bag was found by a railway line near the home Joanne shared with Dyson. But while it was a new lead, it shed no further light on where Joanne herself may be. Then on March 24th, Ray Higgins, the lead detective that I mentioned, passed by an area that happened to fit with the tenuous description of a location that they had teased out of Dyson. It was a completely random finding that was not part of any sort of official search, but this saw Higgins finding Joanne's remains wrapped in bin liners after 39 days of her being missing. Analysis of Joanne's body found that she had been strangled. Quite how that happens accidentally, I'm not entirely sure. Any thoughts on how a man accidentally strangles his girlfriend are welcome in the comments below, but please keep any comments respectful. Accidental. Like many narcissistic cockwombles, Paul Dyson decided the best way to appear as if he wanted to find his partner was to, what a surprise, carry out a televised appeal. And like a great many arseholes that go down this road, it would absolutely prove his undoing. Now, we've seen the appeal video, but let's have a fresh look at that appeal video with some body language analysis, along with what the police saw during that appeal that drew their interest. And it's worth noting that the first knowledge the police had of this TV appeal was when they saw it for themselves on TV. So they had no prior knowledge that this was going to happen.
It's a bit. I just want her back.
That was a long eye closure for 1.5 seconds. But it's a squeeze, it's not a closure. He's squeezing it. And one of the tactics that an individual can use is to squeeze the eyes to try and create the tears to try and get them to run down the cheek to support the display of sadness. We just saw a second eye squeeze there where the eyes closed, but it was a squeeze. And he's sniveling, he's attempting to show sadness, but we'll notice now the brows have dropped. He's not in a sad state anymore, but he's trying to continue the act of portraying he's distressed and concerned and sad. He's clearly attempting to make himself cry or to create tears or create sounds which people might judge to be sadness.
In the interview, there was two marks on his thumbs. I knew from having dealt with other previous assaults and other murders which involved strangulation, the first thing a victim would do is to try and pull those hands away from the neck. Sometimes in doing so, they can leave sort of crescent-shaped fingernail marks in the skin of the offender. When the news crew had zoomed in on Dyson's hands, you could see quite clearly what appeared to me to be two similar crescent-shaped marks on the back of his thumbs. That was the first time I'd been aware of those marks on the back of his thumbs.
When the case finally came to court in November of 2005, Joanne's friends and family prepared themselves for a gruelling trial where they would have to hear all sorts of details that they'd rather not know. In a surprising turn of events, Dyson actually pled guilty on November the 7th, and the need for a full trial was negated. He was sentenced to life in prison with a minimum to be served of 16 years before he could be considered for parole. Now, anyone doing the maths on this may have an inkling why I'm choosing to cover this case. In 2023, we are now about 17 years on from the dramatic events of that Valentine's Day that Dyson later said was the result of Joanne goading him for not knowing how to use their washing machine. At a hearing in October of 2019, it was recommended Dyson be moved to an open prison. The parole board said Dyson's hearing was a pre-tariff review, which can be held up to 3 years before the minimum term of imprisonment, i.e. the 16 years Dyson was ordered to serve, expires. The Secretary of State will only refer pre-tariff cases to the parole board where there is a reasonable prospect of the board making a positive recommendation. A spokesman for the parole board said, "The parole board has made a recommendation to the Ministry of Justice for Paul Dyson to move to an open conditions prison after an oral hearing in October 2019. The parole board confirmed Dyson was directed for release in January 2022, and the prison service confirmed that he was officially released a short time later. It's not clear whether Dyson has returned to Hull or what specific conditions have been placed on him, but he remains on license and any breach will see him returned to prison." The parole board explained that a vigorous process is gone through before a prisoner can be released. A spokesman said, "Parole board decisions are solely focused on what risk a prisoner could present to the public if released, and whether that risk is manageable in the community." A panel will carefully examine a huge range of evidence, including details of the original crime and any evidence of behaviour change, as well as explore the harm done and impact the crime has had on the victims. Members read and digest hundreds of pages of evidence and reports in the lead up to an oral hearing. Evidence from witnesses, including probation officers, psychiatrists and psychologists, officials supervising the offender in prison, as well as victim personal statements, are then given at the hearing. The prisoner and witnesses are then questioned at length during the hearing, which often lasts a full day or more. parole reviews are undertaken thoroughly and with extreme care. Protecting the public is our number one priority. So this shit biscuit has been released, and it would be fair to say that Joanne Nelson's family are less than thrilled. When the family were informed of the move to the open prison in 2019, Joanne's sister Katie Nelson, who was 33 at this time, said, "This man took my beautiful sister's life, thus completely destroying my parents' and my family's life." After serving only 14 of his 16-year prison sentence, he has been granted parole into an open prison for the remaining 2 years. It was a whirlwind of emotions which brought back every single bit of pain. We didn't know what to say to each other or how to comfort each other. The pain is always there. It never goes away. But you learn to suppress it. This brought it all back again. We thought this was a ridiculously lenient sentence for what he did before the murder, during and afterwards. All the hiding and lying that inflicted so much stress and pain on myself and my family. It wasn't an accident. It wasn't a moment of rage. It was an awful, calculated crime he committed. He's now got the chance to potentially start a new life at his age, which makes us feel sick. The family were terrified of bumping into Dyson, having received no assurances that he will be banned from returning to Hull, where the family still live. Katie said, "We don't want him to come back to here, but we haven't been told if there's an exclusion zone. We want to make sure no one in our family puts themselves in any kind of danger. You don't want to bump into the man who killed your family member." An open prison is exactly that. He can come and go as he pleases, become employed, and try to start a new life. This is a totally unfair and unjust decision. I want this monster's face sharing as far and wide as possible. Very strong words. So that brings everything up to date with this case. The killer was released last year. So what do we think about this, gang? I can see two very different viewpoints, with one camp saying he's done his time, he should be released, and the other camp saying this was a vicious murder covered up, and perpetrators of domestic violence never change. So his release is an affront to public safety. I really want to know what you guys think, as I think it's going to be a very divisive thing to discuss. So pop your comments down there and I'll have a little nosy as and when. The video is of course dedicated to Joanne Nelson, who despite being very mature was still just 22 when her life was stolen from her. I hope her family and friends found ways to cope. But as of last year and the news of the release, many old wounds may have been reopened, and I hope that they get the support that they need. Thank you for watching another episode of Murder of Crows. Any subscriptions, likes and shares are very gratefully received. But for now, I'm Steve. This is the Ginger Ninja Samson, and we will see you when we see you.